Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. You two boys and girls, on the day Hogwarts begins new lessons for the year. Today is the day that Albus Severus Potter will be boarding the train to Hogwarts for the first time. And like any good wizard, he's both excited and scared. Anyways, enough of that. Let's get into what this video is actually about. Today, I'm officially 1 week and 2 days past my surgery. So, I'm going to do like a 1 week update, kind of give you guys a how it's been, how it's going. I know in my daily vlogs, I do talk about it quite often, and I've recently done like my morning routine, so some things have changed, but some of the things I've gone over, I'm going to go over in a little more detail. So I do have a list here in front of me, I was just jotting notes down, but the first one on my list is I am still a little tender, like I can't really press on my stomach, I can't lay on my stomach to sleep, which is weird for me, because that's how I normally sleep, is on my stomach. So that's been an interesting thing. But that can take anywhere from 4 to 6 weeks or 2 months to properly alleviate itself. As of about 4 days ago, I haven't taken any pain medication to sleep or anything like that, because it's not interrupting my sleep. I'm not sleeping for completely different reasons. Anyway, so that's new. One of the incisions looks like it's coming. It's trying to peel off. I haven't touched it or anything. I do have weird spots. Like, I've got a spot about right here and over here that are a little more tender than the others, but there's not even an incision there. So that's a little weird, but it's not something I'm super worried about. Mentally, I'm great. Like, I know a lot of people, they say, like, for the first week after or a week after they've had the surgery, they go through like a regret or like a surgery remorse. I'm not there. I haven't had that. I'm not even close to that. Like, I feel great. I feel good about this. Like, it's probably the best decision I've ever made in my life. Mainly because I'm never hungry, and that's a good thing. Like, I don't ever feel hungry, so, like, I'm literally just eating and, well, drinking, to survive, you know? I'm eating to live instead of living to eat, and that was the thing before surgery. I never felt full. I was always hungry, and now it's like I always kind of feel full. I have learned a little bit of the limits about what I can take and how much I can take at one time. Usually, as far as a liquid, I can get about a cup down, so about 8 ounces. I can get down within like a 15-minute time span and not be completely miserable. Any faster than that, and I do tend to get, like, my stomach feels like a wall and I don't want to take anything else in. So, like, my protein shakes, like, I had one today. I sipped it for about 2 hours, and it's like 16 ounces or a little bit more because I put ice in it. So that's new. It's weird too, because like I just watched the Great Britain's baking show. I think I got the name of that wrong. And like normally I'd be like, okay, let's go make something. And I'm like, eh. And my wife's like, why are you watching that? Because you're gonna want those things. And I'm like, I don't though. Like nothing. It's cool, and I'd like to cook those things, but not, like, I'm like, okay, it's just, it's there. I don't want any of it. So the next thing on the list, we'll say the liquid diet. It has been a little rough for me because I'm very limited in what I can and can't have because I'm lactose intolerant, or I was prior to the surgery, and I don't want to venture a risk to find out if I still am. Again, I've heard sometimes the surgery cures it and sometimes not, and I'd rather, while my stomach's still healing, I don't really want to possibly cause any issues. So, it's been a little rough for me. But no, I can't even say it's been rough. It's been weird because it's the same flavors over and over again. I did have an issue where I tried to make homemade like beef cream of like you know like cream of chicken. I tried to make a cream of beef soup, and my stomach definitely didn't agree with that. So that was like a failure. But as far as like the protein shakes, I can take those just fine. I try and change up what liquid I'm drinking each day, and then I drink that for an entire day, and then the next day I get like a new liquid as far as just like protein, you know, like for literally just for hydration. So today was water, and then finally tonight I got sick of water and had some tea with a little bit of Crystal Light lemonade in it. Some days it's fruit punch. I mix it up so that I don't get bored of the same thing because I am so limited. So, A, I'm doing this on a very strict budget, and B, I'm doing it with the limitations of the like no milk-based products. I have found stuff that works. Fairlife milk has 13 grams of protein and like 5 grams of sugar. It's the best thing that I found out there. It tastes like real milk and everything like that. So just a cup of that, and I've already got 13 grams of protein. So where I'm aiming for that 90-gram goal, that really helps me get there. So I've been mixing my medication with that and taking it in the morning. So right off the bat, I'm getting 6 ounces or 6 to 8 ounces of milk and 13 grams of protein. So I also did find a protein-based silk milk that's 10 grams of protein and only like 2 grams of sugar. So that's a little bit cheaper than Fairlife. So if you are trying this on a budget, that's something else. It's Silk Protein Advantage or Protein Plus. You know, 8 ounces of that, you get 10 grams of protein, and you mix that with a 34 gram of protein scoop of powder and drink on that for a couple hours, and you've just put in 40 grams. So that's super cool. I do recommend those if you have lactose issues. But enough about the diet. You know, on Wednesday I hit the puree stage, so like tuna fish and scrambled eggs and boiled eggs, anything that's it can be really soft or mashed up really easily. And even with the tuna fish and like canned chicken, they told me to put it in a blender and puree it some more. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to trying new foods and see how and if their tastes change, because taste buds are one of my things on my list that I've had a little bit of an experience with. So normally like strawberry protein mixes, strawberry flavored anything didn't bother me, and now I can't stand it. It's too chemically tasting to me. So I have found that that's a bit of an issue, considering I was bought a giant canister of strawberry flavored protein mix. So it doesn't bother me as much, and I can cut it in half with like an unflavored protein mix, and that helps a little bit. But as far as my taste buds, that's one of the newest things I've realized that I've developed is a strong hatred for strawberry flavoring, like Jell-O. I don't like strawberry flavored Jell-O anymore, and it used to not be that big a deal. I loved it, so that's been an interesting thing to play with. And I'm kind of curious as to when I get to the puree if any other foods are gonna change. So we'll see as we get along. So taste buds, that is something you can expect to change. And it is something they tell you. Sometimes your taste buds become more refined, sometimes not. Most of the time they become more refined, and for me, I already had very sensitive, refined taste buds. Now it's a little bit worse. So that'll be something to play with and to work through. The next thing on my list is weird noises. My stomach makes all kinds of gurgling and churning noises, and I don't know if it's just like for a few weeks or this is a permanent thing, but like I'll just be sitting there completely quiet. Like today I was working on something, typing something up, and it was quiet in the room, and all I heard was like, blah, 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 and it's very weird because like you can literally hear it like start like right here and kind of work its way down. So weird noises, be prepared for those. With the weird noises, you're gonna burp a lot because the stomach's so small, any air that you get in there is coming right back out immediately. For the first few days, that was pretty rough because it actually hurt like those burps coming back up. It has receded a lot. Like there for, like I said, the first 4 days, I could take little sips, like teaspoon sips of my drink. I'm burping instantly. So now I can be like, okay, now I can just, you know, get a couple ounces in and like slowly swallow those, and it's not so bad. I haven't had as much of an issue with that. So, as far as everything in the other direction, yeah, I mean, it still happens. You're still going to pass gas and stuff like that. It's not like I haven't noticed it being a big issue as far as, like, it's constant, you know what I'm saying? So I don't know if that's just me or if it happens to the people where they get a lot of, like, gas issues. I haven't had that. So yeah, weird noises there. Yeah. Sensitive stomach. Like for the most part, I haven't had one. Now again, I haven't introduced very many new things. So trying to make the cream of beef soup, that's the only new thing I've really introduced to my stomach. And that I did not hit my protein levels yesterday, because this is when I had it. Was it yesterday? I think so. I didn't hit my protein levels yesterday. I got my fluid ounces in because my stomach was just upset after I had it, and that was probably around noonish. I think I made it for lunch. So I hit like 60 grams, so I was not too far away, but I couldn't stomach any other like thick proteiny based anything after that. So I haven't had much experience with a sensitive stomach other than that though. So for me, it hasn't been an issue, but there are chances. You know, your stomach has recently been cut, it's stapled and sewn and all that fun stuff, so it is something to keep an eye on. Previous medications. So I was diabetic when I went into this surgery, diabetic to the point that I was taking 2 injections daily, Levemir and Victoza, and I was at 35 milliliters of, I think it's milliliters, I'm probably, it's a pen style, like an EpiPen. I was at 35 clicks of one and 1.8 clicks of another, which that 1.8 was a full dose of that one. Since my surgery, my sugar has ranged anywhere from the 110 to the 135 range, and they told me as long as my sugar stays under 140, I don't need medication. So I haven't taken my sugar meds since my surgery. I just keep an eye on my sugar. I do keep checking it. I do have an appointment coming up to see my primary physician and discuss that with him some more, but they basically told me if on the sliding scale, as long as I stay between that range, I don't have to take it. So that's pretty awesome, because that was always a chore at night, was taking that medication and having to stab yourself twice, you know. Eventually you get used to it, but at the same time, it's exciting to be beyond that. So all my other medications, the only medication that I was taking prior to the surgery is my naproxen for my shoulders. And I'm still taking that because I do still have some issues with my shoulders. I don't think that's something that's just going to go away. I think I'll probably have to talk to an orthopedic doctor and have them look into the x-rays and stuff on my shoulders. So, weird bruises. So, and they're just from the surgery, the bruises I have. So, like, I'm still pretty bruised here where I had an IV. That's where they stuck me with an IV. You can still see my IV there. I'm bruised here. There's a little bruising on my stomach under one of my incisions. It's not bad, though. They do say, like, if you get, like, weird, real bad bruising, to give them a call. It hasn't been like that. So I do have a weird bruise on my shoulder though that I have to have a conversation with my surgeon about, because it had a little look like an injection site. I wasn't awake when that happened. I don't know what they injected me with, and I just have this bruise here. I will say, whatever it was, for about 3 to 4 nights after the surgery, like coming home, I woke up in like miserable pain in my shoulder, and I kind of chalked it off to my pre-existing issues with my shoulder, but I'm gonna find out what that was about just to see if maybe there was a side of it. Again, I haven't had the issue since about 3 or 4 days after, so a few days ago. So that was a weird thing. Other than that, no weird bruises. Like a lot of my incisions didn't even bruise. They're a little red, you know, where the glue and stuff is, but for the most part, my incisions are fine. You know, I did talk about weird noises and not being on pain meds. Even the day of my surgery, I could do this. So you see me patting my stomach. I'm not patting it too hard because everything underneath is still sore, but like the actual bruises or the actual incisions don't hurt to the touch at all whatsoever. So I don't know if they were supposed to. They never did, actually. So either he did a bang-up job or I healed fast as far as the outer layer goes. Again, the deep layers are still really sore, though. So I've been very careful not to lift too much because I'm not supposed to lift over like 10 or 15 pounds for at least 2 weeks. Two or four. Ugh, I hope it's not four. Two at least. And I've probably broken that rule a couple times. Probably in the last 3 hours when I lifted our dog. So, other than that, the next thing, I have noticed some of my clothes fitting a little bit smaller. Normally I would wear a 7X t-shirt because I like them a little bit longer. Now my 6Xs are almost to where I preferred my 7Xs to be. And this is actually a 5X, which I would have never even thought about putting on. It is still a little short as far as I'm concerned, and it rides up a little bit because of my stomach. So, but it's well on its way to fitting properly. And even sitting here like this, it fits just fine. It doesn't ride up. When I'm walking, it does ride. And it would be too snug to wear as far as, because I wear suspenders, I also wear an undershirt, and this would be my overshirt. So I don't think it would fit quite yet for the way I dress. But my 6Xs fit great, whereas before they were pretty short. So that's awesome. All my stretchy shorts that I've been wearing, they're getting baggier a little bit as well. So I have to like hike them up more often and tie the drawstring a little bit tighter. So that's kind of cool. Not like super big changes, just little ones. So again, I would wear 6X shirts. I just preferred them a little bit longer, and they're getting a little bit longer. So you can see, as far as my clothes go, you know, it's a good thing. I did get a little adventurous and try on a 3X. It fits great from here up. It wouldn't go any further than that. So we'll get there in due time. Let's see, food temperatures. So beforehand, I could like make a glass of iced tea, and if the ice all melted before I finished with it, I could still drink it at like room temperature. No, I can't do it anymore. Like I had lukewarm, like room temperature warm water, and I had to keep ice in it. Like I don't want anything lukewarm. I want it cold. I don't know if that's a part of the surgery or if I'm just getting weirder as I get old. I definitely don't like lukewarm anything. So the last thing on my list and the most interesting thing is temperature change as far as my body goes. Normally, if I was in the house, I'd have to have the air on 74 and I was still sweating. Since my surgery, I'm home by myself and I keep the air at 79. Very rarely do I even get warm, and if I do, I can turn on a fan at a very low level, and eventually within 30 minutes, if I don't turn it off, I'm getting under covers because I get cold, and that's not normal for me. If you knew me prior, like, I was always hot, I was always sweating, could be standing in a freezer at negative 20 degrees, and I was sweating, and now it's the complete opposite. So I'm very sensitive to environmental temperature changes, whether it's hot or cold. So, like, I'm sure since my wife's gotten home tonight, she's turned the air down. My legs are cold. So that's been a unique change. And the fact that I haven't been sweating as much, part of that is that a lot of my sugar is down to normal. I'm sure my sodium levels are down. So, like, my blood's cleaning itself out. It's not as thick. you know, a lot of the, you know, some of the weight loss is causing my body not to have to overwork itself, and so I'm not getting as hot as fast, so that's been pretty cool. And yeah, it gets warm, and I can tell it's warmer than normal, but it's not uncomfortably warm. So even walking to getting the kids in back, you know, with it being 79, 80 degrees, I don't feel completely miserable as far as the heat on my skin and stuff goes. So those have been some unique changes, some interesting things I've gone through, and some of the things I've noticed, you know, post a week and a few days. So I think I'll try and do this every so often, just kind of give you guys like every so often update as far as new things, especially once I hit the puree and like a week into the puree, I'll come back and give you guys an update how that's going and if there's any foods I found that I can't stand or if my temperature changes or my temperature requirements change or any other weird noises and things like that. I do hope you guys enjoyed this video. A side note, I will tell you, I did suffer my first bout of like post-surgery like constipation issues today, and it was pretty rough. The stuff they gave me that's supposed to keep that from happening isn't working, so I'm gonna go to Miralax and use that instead of what they gave me, because what they gave me tastes completely wretched. Miralax isn't that bad, and Miralax I know for sure works, whereas that stuff doesn't. So I will tell you, stay as hydrated, hit the water levels even if you don't hit the protein levels to keep that from happening, because that, I tell you what, that was the roughest 4 hours of my life. On top of that, they did tell me that maybe I'm taking too much calcium, so I'm cutting my calcium in half, probably by two-thirds, to see if that helps with any issues. So I know that's a little gross news, but I thought I'd share that because it was just in my mind. But again, hope you guys enjoyed this video. Do me a favor and give it a thumbs up and subscribe if you want to see more. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's always fabulous when you join me. Till tomorrow.